my parents wanted to get me in the school because they said that graduates from Xavier were more disciplined and more likely to succeed in life. Am I right?
Yes!
Unfortunately, I did not make it. But instead, I ended up in a another Jesuit-run institution, which is the Ateneo. Now, I don't know if that was a turn for the worse or not, but I'd rather not comment. So anyway, my only hope is that our common Jesuit training will help me connect more with you. Anyway, my dear friends, I am Geraldine. I am the representative of the First District of Bataan, but I think that most of you here know me for being the first transgender, openly transgender person to win a seat in Congress. Am I right? Yes. And when you mention the word or the name Geraldine Roman, you normally think of LGBT rights or gender equality. And it seems that the media, learning institutions like Xavier School and government have all focused on that one aspect of my being, which is my being a transgender person. Now you may ask yourselves, does she enjoy being branded or typecast or stereotyped as a transgender woman and as an LGBT rights activist? You want me to tell you the truth? Actually, I do not enjoy that, nor do I like it. Because if you ask any transgender person, you know, we spend almost our entire lives struggling to assert our true gender identity. So the last thing we want in our lives is to be branded precisely as transgender people and to be constantly reminded of our life story. We just want to blend in the crowd. Plus, I also want to remind you just like you, I am a multifaceted person. I also happen to be the obedient and dutiful yet somewhat rebellious daughter to my parents. I am the sweet but domineering better half of my lifetime partner. I am a doting aunt to my nephews and nieces. And I have very few friends because I tend to be shy and I just enjoy staying at home. I love reading, I love religious art, and I also love history and running. And in Congress, I'm also an advocate of World War II veterans, caregivers, education, environment, and I have passed bills. I have filed bills in the lower house for these advocacies. Anyway, I don't enjoy it. But I do realize that although there have been advances in the fight for LGBT rights, there are still bigots in our society. And there is still prejudice and discrimination against my brothers and sisters in the LGBT community. So if it means that my being branded as a transgender woman or my having to recount my life story over and over again will open your eyes and will open your hearts so that you can understand and accept people like me, then I don't mind recounting my story, I don't mind being typecast. So let me share my story with you. You know, my life story is just like the life story of any transgender person. You know what being a transgender person is, right? It's being born with a gender identity that does not correspond with your anatomical sex at birth. Meaning that you are born with the body of a boy, but your heart, your mind, your mindset, everything within is that of a woman, and vice versa, if you happen to be a transgender man. So, I grew up in a very Catholic family. We are a family of five, and I had no sisters before. I had two brothers. So, all I can remember as a child was that I enjoyed doing things that were considered as feminine. I enjoyed playing with my clay pots and pans with my cousins. I enjoyed playing with dolls. I enjoyed playing Chinese garter and jackstone. And I just did things that came out naturally to me. But I did notice that the adults and the older kids were calling my attention, and they were telling me not to do these things. They were telling me, stop doing that because you will get teased. Stop doing that because that's not for boys. And honestly, I did not understand them, because as a child and as children, I'm sure all of you also did not brand your behavior as masculine or feminine. You just simply did what came out naturally to you. And it was also the same in my case. So true enough, when I started studying, well, children can be very cruel. So they started teasing me, my classmates. Some of my classmates also started bullying me. And although I kept trying to keep a strong face and not facade, I got hurt inside. But there were also good classmates who tried to defend me. What I did was I tried to excel in academics, and this is how I gained their respect. And then I went to Ateneo for high school. That was an all-boys school. That was an all-boys school. And this was way back in the 80s. My God, can you imagine? Talaga naman, they were laughing at me and they were mocking me, they were imitating my behavior. Sometimes they turned a little violent, but I was lucky. You know why? Because the Jesuits took notice and they saw that I was being bullied and they protected me. And I'm eternally grateful to the Jesuits. Are you? Anyway, I also remember that our guidance counselor in high school, the late brother died. How he made me his protege. And he would give me valuable advice. He would tell me, you know what? As long as you know that you're not hurting anyone, just be yourself and don't mind the insults and the bullying. And try to excel also in academics. I was so happy there, feeling protected, and eventually I got respected and accepted by my classmates. And that was the reason I became so sad when I started college at the University of the Philippines. You know, at the University of the Philippines, you meet all kinds of people. And I met people like me. So it makes a difference if you realize that you are not the only person who is actually transgender. And they talk to you, they give you advice. And I realized that I had options. I started growing my hair long. I started wearing a little bit of makeup and being true to myself. And that was a liberating experience, because when you become true to yourself, it feels good. And then after college, thank God, I received a scholarship to study in Spain, where I took my master's degrees. And in Spain, you know, it was so funny. I remember the first time I went to a big department store, El Corte Inglés, and I had to go to the toilet. So I was heading towards the men's comfort room, because at the University of the Philippines, I had gotten used to using the men's comfort room, because there was clear-cut policy with regard to the use of restrooms and toilets. And at the UP, I would wait until all the men had left before using the toilet. So I was in Spain, I was at the Corte Inglés, I was heading towards the toilet, and then there were men at the entrance, and they told me, no, señorita, aquí no está, this is not the ladies' comfort room, and you have to go to the ladies' comfort room. And I told myself, Eddie Wong. Maganda. Finally, here was a place where people actually expected me to behave in accordance with my true gender identity. And this is the place where I blossomed, because, you know, it's a European country and their laws are very protective. They have very clear-cut anti-discrimination laws. And gender actually was never an issue for me in Spain. I guess there were also people who could read through me, maybe who suspected that I was born a man. But they never mentioned it. We just studied, we just mingled, and we socialized, and their problem. Anyway, also in Spain, I developed very close friendships, and my close friends, the few ones who actually knew my life story, they asked me, Geraldine, you're already living as a woman, you look like a woman, why don't you take that final step, which is sex reassignment surgery, so that you don't have to feel uncomfortable with yourself. So I called my father long distance. There was no Skype in those days. And I told him, Daddy, these are my options. My father was not surprised because he would visit me year after year in Spain, and he would see me transition into womanhood. And he flew to Spain and then told me, let's go to New York, because I heard that they do sex reassignment surgery very well in that city. So together we flew to New York. We sought the services of a psychotherapist to ensure that, you know, what I felt, what I believed, was certified by a professional, that I am a person who is a transgender woman. And after seeing that psychotherapist, we went and sought the services of a surgeon. But before actually undergoing surgery, I told my father, Daddy, I want to see Brother Dunn, our guidance counselor in high school. As I said, we are a very Catholic family, and before we make life-changing decisions, we normally pray and seek guidance. We try to discern what God wants in our lives. So I saw Brother Dan. I remember that day I went to his office. At first, he could not recognize me. But then, he stared at me, and then he finally recognized who I was. I told him, Brother Dan, I have these options. And then he kept quiet for some few minutes, and then he told me, Geraldine, the body is just a shell. If you feel that by modifying the outside, you can become a better, more loving, more generous person, then go ahead. Because God looks at the heart and not at your body. And I heaved a sigh of relief. I was very thankful because this is what I believed all my life, that there is nothing wrong with being true to oneself, even as a Catholic. I can reconcile the fact that I am a Catholic and that I am being true to myself. So finally, I underwent surgery. My mother, my father, and my brothers were there to give me moral support. I even remember after the surgery that I was wheeled into my room, there was my father waiting for me with a bouquet of white roses. He had set up a small altar filled with estampitas, or holy cards of my favorite saints. And the rest is history. You know what? If I were to describe that day, I would describe that day as my rebirth. My rebirth. And I was very, very happy because finally I was not uncomfortable with my physical anatomy. And I could continue living the life of a normal person. So I went back to Spain, I took another master's degree, I found a job, I met my lifetime partner, we've been together for the past 19 years, and I enjoyed Spain, traveling, learning its history, mastering its language, and everything that comes with my stay here. So you may ask, what are you doing here in the Philippines? You were so happy in Spain. Well, way back in 2012, my father fell ill. He was a smoker, and he was diagnosed with 4-stage emphysema. So I told myself that because he had loved me and supported me and accepted me unconditionally, that I should return the love by taking care of him. I thought it would be a 6-month vacation. Well, it didn't turn out to be that way. But during that time when I was taking care of him, we would have these very intimate conversations. You know, when a person is dying, you talk about everything without shame, as if to catch up for lost time. so we would talk about everything under the sun. But he posed this very, as we say, mind-boggling question to me. This was his question. He said, "Geraldine, you don't have any children. What is the meaning of your life?" You know, I have to admit to you that I was already in my early 40s at that time. Ayan, I gave away a clue already. And I was already beginning to ask the same question to myself. Because it happens to everyone. You know, we have our dreams, our top dreams. We want to finish our studies, we finish our studies. We want to find a job, we find a job. We want to save, buy a house, buy a car, but we keep on asking ourselves, what's next? And I was doing the same. I was asking myself, what is next? So when he asked me that question, I answered him, "Daddy, what do you want me to tell you? I mean, I'm enjoying life. I'm traveling, I'm saving, I'm shopping." And this he told me, "Geraldine, remember this. As long as your life revolves around yourself and you do not help others, your life has no true meaning." And I took it as a personal challenge from my father because, you know, I come from a political family. My father was a congressman, my mother was a congresswoman. I took it as a personal challenge to me to continue the service in the tradition of public service in my family. And I decided that I would join what I thought would be the happy world of politics. Public service is fine, makes you feel happy. But politics is different. As they say, there are two sides to a coin. Politics is the ugly side. Public service is the good side. So here I am in Congress, and I'm fighting for my advocacy. First and foremost, the stereotype, the branding that has been given to LGBT rights and gender equality. But I am also fighting for World War II veterans, for teachers, for our educational system, also for agriculture, livelihood, infrastructure, tourism, the environment. And I pass bills for all of these. So to all of you, maraming maraming salamat. Thank you.